All right, it's time to bring it over with your email questions. And we are going to start out with Kay. She says, I volunteer at this church where a person is doing things that are immoral and questionable. People have seen him at the crack house, and I've witnessed him stealing. He started a men's group and seems to have the confidence of the people in charge. I don't want to make waves, but I'm concerned. I mean, I feel that if I say something, someone will think it's personal. How should I handle this? And is there any biblical guidance on situations like this?
There absolutely is. You that are spiritual, when you see somebody overtaken in a fault, I'm quoting the Bible, go to such a one in the spirit of meekness, lest you yourself be tempted. And you want to take people with you and confront this. Now, I tell you what, you've got this guy going to this crack house. The cameras, take pictures. Say, listen, you're out there using crack. I saw you stealing, and you know, you got to get your life right. But take people with you, those who are spiritual. You see somebody overtaken in a fault, go to someone, spirit of meekness, lest you yourself be tempted. That's what the Bible says. That's the rule, okay?
Okay. Elizabeth says, my husband was born and raised in Hawaii. Many of his friends are Buddhists, and some of them we've invited over to our house. But in the Bible, in 2 John 10 and 11, it says that if anyone comes to you and does not bring this doctrine, do not receive him into your house nor greet him, for he who greets him shares in his evil deeds. Now, does this mean that we can't be friends with them anymore? And how are we supposed to minister to people if we can't be friends with them?
I tell you, that's a little bit extreme, what you just read and quoted. The Apostle Paul said, look, if somebody's called a brother and they're immoral, they're thieves, they're drunkards, you're not even supposed to eat with them. But other than that, you've got to associate with people in the world who do all these things, lest you go out of the world. That's what the Apostle Paul said. And I mean, we live in a world that's got people that engage in evil conduct. So, of course, you get together with people who are Buddhists and others in order to let your light shine into their lives. But if somebody says, I'm a brother, I'm a Christian, but I am immoral, I'm sleeping around, I'm stealing stuff, I'm drunk, cut them off. All right?
Okay. Next question's from Andy, who says, I am under horrendous stress in a highly complex work environment. The demands are more than I can possibly get done, so I spend long hours trying to satisfy my superiors. I'm on call constantly, living with my computer and cell phone almost surgically attached, and I never seem to have any peace. I feel that I'm cheating my family, but I can't afford to quit my job, and I'm good at what I do. How do I juggle both? I need my job, but I need my family to be happy.
Sounds like to me you're a slave. What are businesses for? They're to make money. And who do they make money for? They make money for the stockholders or the owners. So if you're not a stockholder or an owner, you're a slave to somebody else's economic future. You don't have to do that. Now, you could do a couple of things. First of all, you could go to the guy that's the owner and say, listen, I want to be a supervisor. I want to get a raise because I'm doing all this wonderful work, and I'm getting $50,000 a year. I think I ought to get $75,000, or I'm getting $75,000. I think I ought to get $100,000 or whatever. So that's number one. So you get a bigger piece of the pie. Number two, you've got to say, listen, I have a family, I have a wife, and I have children, and I owe them something because they're very important in my life, and I've got to have more time with it, and I want a work schedule that involves this. And the other thing is, you say, I've smashed my cell phone, and I'm not taking any more calls. Or you just put your cell phone on, you know, auto dial or whatever you put it on, and don't take any calls. You're not a slave. It's all money, folks. It's about money. And you cannot be a slave to money. So it's time you break it free and you say, well, I can't lose my job. If you're as good as you say you are, you can get another job. Maybe you can start your own business. All right.
Okay. Well, Ashley, I think that's good.
You think that's good?
I do. In fact, can I say something? A girlfriend of mine, she is a high corporate position, mad money, mad power position. And she told me, she said, she does contract work, that a company had called her, and they called her on the weekend, and she said, I told you from the beginning don't call me on the weekends. I will get my job done. I'll give you what you want, but don't call me on the weekend. So they called her on the weekend. I said, what did you do? She goes, I picked up the phone and hung it up. And I said, why did you do that? To show them I was not taking their call. She's like, and they haven't called me since. I said, well, amen, sister, for you.
Maybe they didn't call and give her any work either.
All right, I know. Ashley writes in and says, our church just began a 45-minute express worship service for busy people. The service is mostly praise and worship and some announcements, no preaching and no sermons. I know worship is important, but isn't teaching God's word even more important? The service has doubled in just a few weeks, and this concerns me. Do I have a right to be concerned?
Of course you have a right to be concerned. Mm-hmm. That's outrageous. You know, the big deal in architecture of churches, the old church had an altar in the center. The center of the worship was the communion and where the priest went and he offered up the host and all the things that they do. Then, with the Protestant Reformation, they took the altar they had and put it on one side someplace, and they put the pulpit in the middle. So the architecture of the churches focuses around the pulpit. Why? Because they said preaching of the Word of God is central in our churches. Now, the church you're talking about, they neither focus in on the sacraments, nor do they focus on preaching. And I wouldn't have anything to do with it. I mean, if that's the way it is, you know, Hybels, who had those secret churches, he finally came out and said, you know, in all these years, I had huge crowds, but said, I was wrong. I did something wrong. I wasn't bringing these people to faith in Jesus. And I don't care what it is. So they sing some songs, and they play tambourines and dance around, and they go home, and that's supposed to be church? No way.
Good job, because listen, the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word was God, the Word was with God, so the church needs to be centered, focused on the Word. Boom.